To introduce myself, my name is Hanan Youssef. I take care of the early stage investments and new venture development in A15. And I'm also a Tech Women alumni, so I have a special interest in this topic. So I'll start by just asking my great panelists to give us a brief introduction about themselves, and then we'll go through the discussion.
Sure. Is everybody feeling awesome? Great. My name is Salma Al-Hariri. To give you a little bit of a brief about myself, I graduated from AUC in 2009 with both a degree in computer science and business. I actually started off with being just a computer science, but I ended up falling in love with the business side of technology instead of just being a computer science and geeking out all day. So I merged both and basically graduated with that. Fast forward a number of years, I decided to move to Silicon Valley and basically start my master's degree in digital marketing. Over there, I fell in love with the opportunities of really inspiration in the air. Everyone is working on the next big thing. Technology is more than up in the air over there. So I got inspired to actually start an accelerator program to support growth stage entrepreneurs and startups to have access to the same network, same mentors, same ideology that I was presented with, and basically replicate myself, but have mini-me's. I currently run Egypt Innovate, which is an online platform that promotes entrepreneurship and innovation. And basically what we're trying to do is we're trying to include those marginalized women, people outside of Cairo and Alex, and give them access to the same knowledge that people over here actually have. That's me in a nutshell.
Oh, okay, that's better. Hi, everyone. I'm Elmira Bayrosli. I am a writer, lecturer, an entrepreneur. I teach global entrepreneurship at NYU, at New York University. And I run a startup called Foreign Policy Interrupted. And it is a media education platform that is, the goal is to increase female voices in the media. And I can talk, I think that'll be one of the opportunities that I'll talk about. But I'm also here, I'm really delighted to be here for Rise Up, because in September I published a book that I've been working on for a very long time called From the Other Side of the World, Extraordinary Entrepreneurs, Unlikely Places. And it is a look at the rise of global entrepreneurship in different places, in different countries around the world. So I hope that you will support a writer and pick one up.
Hi everyone, it's lovely seeing you here. I am Ruba Musa and I work in Orange Business Services, which is a multinational telecommunications company in product development. And you're probably wondering what I'm doing here. I represent corporate, but I am a co-founder and a STIRCO member of an initiative that is called W Egypt, and it's a diversity support network for women, I have to say for men as well. And the objective of the network is to help women break the glass ceiling, extend their potential, network, and build a network that will help them succeed. Thank you.
Hi, Amira Rashad. I head up the brand business for Facebook in the Middle East, North Africa, and Pakistan. I am here actually in a dual capacity. I also am a board member of TechWedi, which is a networking organization that supports entrepreneurs in the region and helps them network in Silicon Valley. I'm here because I'm extremely excited about the potential that exists within this region for entrepreneurs in general and women specifically, given the level of education in this part of the world and in Egypt specifically. And just can't wait to start and can't wait to see the potential and the next unicorn that's coming out of this region. So very excited.
Hi everyone, I'm very happy to be with you today and to see all of the energy and the bright faces in this room. My name is Mariam Kiriakos. I work as a business consultancy manager at Flink Development. And my role is mainly something between technology and business. So I get engaged with clients who are mainly nowadays governments in understanding the specific business problem, then that going into the technology roadmap of how could we solve this problem. So I go every day to work. I have a question that I'm curious about, like how can we improve the investment climate in Zimbabwe? I've never been there, and I'm thinking about it from technology versus business perspective. So this is what I'm doing for a living. I'm also, I graduated from AUC in 2006 as a computer science major, and I continued my research in context-aware business process modeling. And I graduated from the master's in 2012, and I'm a continuing researcher, so I'm interested also in academia and opportunities for women in academia in the field of technology, and I'm a founder of Aspire program. I founded it 2 months ago, which is for teaching technology to children in underprivileged areas. So that's basically me, and I'm just back from Tech Women program, which is a very interesting program for women in technology. It's an initiative by the US Department of State, and I'll be wearing the Exchange Program's hat today.
Thank you so much. We have really a great group of women with us on the panel. So to get us started, I think there has been a lot of discussions recently about the fact that when people start their careers in a corporate, you typically have an equal number of women and men. And then as they advance to a more advanced level and more managerial levels, that number seems to drop. So I'd like to start by asking you guys, maybe Amira, if you can take us through your path to the top of one of the biggest digital companies in the region. What are the challenges that women face, and how can they get further up the line in the corporate world?
So I want to start by saying that there's no question that women have to be responsible for a lot of things, both from a professional perspective, but also from the family side of things. Be it parents or children or other endeavors. The real point that I want to kind of emphasize as a main starting point to think about this is that you are in the driver's seat. You pretty much decide what you want to do. And I think that one of the reasons why a lot of women don't get as far as they deserve is because they do not advocate for themselves. And I don't want to generalize, but women in general tend to want to please, tend not to want to be seen as, you know, pushing the boundaries or, you know, ruffling any feathers or what. And by no means am I advocating, you know, being rude or working outside of the culture or what have you. But there's a lot to be said for standing up for yourself, knowing what you want, and making a proactive step or two to make sure that you get that. So in my case, it was about, so I graduated from AUC, as my son would say, in the 19s. And what I did was I got a little bit of work experience, but then I realized very quickly that I needed to know a little bit more. So I applied for a scholarship, got it, went and got a master's degree. And contrary to what most people were you know, asking or questioning, started working in other markets. Now, I was lucky enough to have a family that was supportive of that, and they didn't question this, you know, this recent single girl going off being an expat somewhere. In fact, they supported it, which was a huge, huge part. So, A, stand up, advocate for yourself. B, it is really an ecosystem, so your family needs to support you. You need to be very, very supportive of your network as well. It isn't just one entity. But then as one of my personal heroes or someone I actually look up to, Sheryl Sandberg, says, marry right. Marry someone or get in a relationship with someone who will support you, who understands those challenges, who will be willing to, you know, take a step or two with you in that same direction in order for them to be excited about your potential and the opportunities going forward. So I guess education helps. Standing up for yourself helps. Being part of a network, once you are actually in a corporate setup, really, really helps, because you start having mentors, you start having people that you can bounce ideas off of, and it becomes this virtuous cycle where you can actually learn as you go and as you attempt to take that next step.
Great. So I think you brought up a very interesting point about the existence of a network and having that group of women or people that can support you in the organization. And I think a lot of organizations are starting to have these diversity groups to support women getting to the top. And Roba, I know you have an experience with that. Can you share with us a little bit more about what you're doing and how you're supporting women get up there?
The network first, I'll just say briefly how it all started. It's a very funny story. I was working in sales and marketing in the region, and I was responsible for supporting a customer based in the region. And it was like a 3-year life cycle for selling the deal. And during these times, I had to like travel. And believe it or not, we would sit on a table where we discuss technical issues and everyone will just listen. I'm the only woman in the room. I'm the only one on the table, which is fine. But then we would go out for dinner and they would sit away. And I would sit with an empty chair on the right and an empty chair on the left. And they wouldn't even talk to me. And believe it or not, we were once supposed to have a meeting in one of their offices. And I didn't go. Guess why? They don't have a women's toilet in the building. And there's 1,000 men and not a single woman. So it was a big challenge, and that's where I started thinking, you know, I don't face these things in Orange, which is fine, but I face them in the market and in other companies. And we grouped together with other women who have the same challenges, and we've decided to build a network. We went to our senior vice president of HR in Orange, and she's a woman. And we told her what we were facing in challenges, and it was surprising to hear that she was very motivated and supportive. Not because she thinks we are going to build a network that positively or negatively discriminates one gender against the other. It is contrary, the opposite. It is, the point is, we have all the possible rules in Orange for gender equality, equal pay, equal opportunity, and still we see very little women, as you said, that climb over the ladder. And it is always something that is in their back mind, in their, in their culture, the way they were raised, that challenged them and stops them. So she was supportive because she said putting the environment is not enough. It's setting the rules, building the environment, and building the network, the success network that will help you grow. And that's how it all started. So we have 9 steer co-members in Egypt. We all have different initiatives to support the program. Today, Egypt was the first international network outside of France because Orange is a French company. And we have 10 networks. And imagine we have in the United States, in Germany, in France, in Denmark, in Nordics, in Mauritius, in India, and all of those networks work together to support women and support, I would like to say, diversity, not really women, it's the diversity where it is required. And we called it W, so it is W Egypt, and W is the network. We have different programs, and one of them we mainly focus on leadership, where we have leadership trainings, leadership sessions for management, where we try to tell them how men and women are all different in the way they communicate and in their different leadership style, and how all those different activities can help in achieving their own dreams and in the ambition of Orange Business Services in the market. One of those programs is meeting a leader, and it's sometimes physical when we can, sometimes digital when we can't. And the objective is to bring in people to meet executives in the company where we can exchange information, learn, be mentored, be coached, as you said, get the support we need. And the only interesting feedback I can remember now is that one of those executives said it was useful for him more than us, because he's got the energy, he's seen the innovation, he's seen the people, and it has inspired him and motivated him a lot to do changes in his own organization. So it's actually a double-way relationship.
So I think a lot of what we've been discussing is really about the glass ceiling. Does it exist, and how do women break it? We've seen examples from the personal life, from building networks. Elmira, I know you've talked about a lot of entrepreneurs and executives who've done that. So what do you think about the glass ceiling, and how can women break it?
Thanks so much. I think that just dovetailing on what Amira and Ruba said was, I think there's a lot of institutional barriers. I think just in the 20th century, the way businesses were set up, it was set up in a way where the advantages were all for men. Now that women are getting into the workforce and the dynamics are changing,
you're starting to see a lot of, like, the glass ceiling being shattered. But I don't think it's just, I think they're that doing things like diversity programs and rules and changing the rules are certainly important. But I also think that, at least from what I've seen in my work, there is what Amira said. I think that there is an unconscious bias. I think there's an unconscious bias about what women are capable of, not just by men, but I also think by women too. I think women limit themselves. And I think this comes down to an issue of, you know, how do we shatter the psychological glass ceiling? You know, how do I actually achieve that? And this comes down to a question of confidence. And so I think it's appropriate to have this discussion at a startup conference here in Cairo, because I think that what we're seeing with the emergence of entrepreneurs in places like Egypt, we're also, I think women too in technology are starting to come up and gain that confidence to say, you know, I want that promotion, and I want a higher salary, and I want that maternity leave, and there are certain things that I want, not because I'm capable of it, and I'm talented. And I think that certainly what I've seen with the entrepreneurs that I have talked to around the world, people ask me what separates the men from the women, and I say absolutely nothing. The thing that I find that they all share in common is this confidence that they believe in themselves and they believe in their ideas. And it's hard to be an entrepreneur, right? Because people often tell you your idea is crazy, you're out there trying to get customers, you're trying to raise capital. And for women, I think it's a lonely road too, because if you're not building those networks, and those networks are not there. And here is where I also, you know, where the sisterhood comes in. You know, and I'm a big supporter. I think, you know, women need to support other women. And sometimes I feel like, you know, sometimes we do a disservice to ourselves because we think that the platform is so small and we're not willing to support one another. And I think we need to stop the sister side. You know, like, we need to stop, you know, tearing down one another and really start building one another up, because, like, your success is actually really good for me. You know, you being at Facebook is I think that's fantastic for every woman here, you know, because it really is an entree, because you're in a position where you can do that. And I think that if we're developing that confidence in whether you're an entrepreneur or you're a woman in technology at whatever level. And I think the other thing we need to think about is we're always encouraging women, you know, to go out there and code. And I love that you're a coder. I mean, like, you go, girl. I love that. But we also need to actually harness different talents, and we need to own that. And I think that it's okay that if you have women who don't want to be in the C-suite, who don't want to be the CEO, we should allow that woman to be whoever we want. Men, there are men at every level of business. They're at entry level, they're at mid-level, they're CEOs, and we don't gang up on men who don't do that. And so we also need to respect women and the choices they make, because that's also about, you know, again, it's about choices and it's about what you want out of your life.
What's really interesting here is that when we talk about this, typically it's about the opportunity. You want to make sure that the opportunity is there for a woman who wants to go to the C-suite. The opportunity is there for a woman who wants to be an entrepreneur, and she can get funding, and she can get follow-up funding if she needs to. So maybe let's just get a little bit focused on the MENA region. And Salma, I know you've worked with a lot of organizations and a lot of women entrepreneurs as well. So can you give us a sum up of what is it like for a woman in the corporate and the entrepreneurship world in MENA at this point of time?
Sure. So I just want to say I love that you say I code, but I actually stopped coding ever since I graduated. and that brings me to the point is I actually really didn't fit in that much with the coding network over here, because I think society also puts a pressure to expect you to look a certain way or feel the certain way in order to be a coder. So that also made me really wonder, what is it that I'm good at, and what is it that I can bring to the table? And I felt like my personal skills and social skills were far stronger than my coding skills, and that's why I decided to actually step more into the game of business, the business side of technology, and not the coding side of technology, which is really interesting, because you have to also look at the challenges as if they're actually something that is positive, and you have to turn everything that is a glass ceiling or you know, something that is capping you up into a more of an opportunity. And that's, I think, what I've done. And I think what I've seen happen with a lot of the entrepreneurs and the entrepreneurs and the intrapreneurs, the ones that are actually in the companies, they're not really waiting for the opportunity to knock the door, but they're actually creating their own opportunities. I've seen that with so many amazing women. I mean, I can mention a few names, like Rana Al-Ayoubi. She's actually an Egyptian entrepreneur, and she's went on to MIT to do a PhD around Audacity, and actually she started a company called Effectiva, and right now it's one of the two watch global startups. She's raised more than $20 million. That's an example of an epic woman who comes from our same background. You tend to really think when you see all these examples that, oh, she's far away, or oh, she's probably had a better privilege or something else, but she really built a support network around her. And I want to emphasize the idea of support networks. Support networks are really important. If you can't see one in your local community, actually build one. There's so many organizations. I can actually name a few. Women 2.0 is one. You can start a chapter right here if you don't see one. Girls in Tech. There's a Girl in Tech chapter, I think, in more than 300 cities around the world. And it's typically a really light networking event where women can come together or girls can come together. And we actually do invite men in the party as well. It's not just women. What I mean by women support groups is just that we tend to not really shy from talking about the challenges and creating the opportunities, but we also put our foot on the pedestal and basically try to push forward the industry and try to push forward the entrepreneurial ecosystem. As for entrepreneurship, I see that it's really important in the 21st century to equip yourself with digital skills. So basically you can become a coder, or you can become a digital consultant, or you can become someone who does UX, or just out of your home. If you really can't go and work in the workplace, you can actually create a new opportunity and go online to this thousands of jobs that are out there, from Elance, from Nebbish, our actually regional clone of Elance, which is basically a space for freelancers to offer the skills in exchange of dollars and opportunities. You have that track, as well as you also have, if you want to really start a business, and if you want to be a woman entrepreneur, there's so many angel groups that are forming. There's one in Dubai called Womena, and it's basically just an angel network out of the wealthy Gulf ladies that wanted to support women that basically are starting their businesses. So Women as another example, and I can bet you there's most accelerators and incubators actually have a diversity matrix where every cycle they actually question whether or not they have women startups, or even if it's not a fully women startup, then maybe actually it's one where there's a woman, at least one woman in the foundership structure. So there's so many opportunities that are already being created. There's an entire ecosystem of support. The real question is, are you really grabbing these opportunities, or are you shying away from them? And if you're shying away from them, then you need to do something, and it starts from you, and it doesn't really start from someone else. So
I think that's really a great introduction to start discussing some of these opportunities and some of these platforms that exist to get women forward. And Maryam, I know you wanted to share with the audience here something about exchange programs and how that kind of early global exposure can really help women start their careers in the different organizations.
Exactly. I'll first start with my experience. I'm just back from a program, it's called Tech Women Program, and it's mainly for supporting women up to 2 years of experience and onwards to have the right network. Talk about the network and the importance to get support to get into the right opportunities or to advance in your career. And many times in our career, we do not have this idea of mentorship. We do not have the idea of the opportunities are not any everywhere. You do not have the support network easily. Sometimes your family is supportive, sometimes your corporate, but sometimes you do not have the support ecosystem. But throughout the exchange program, I've been with 99 very inspiring women from 20 countries in Africa, Middle East, and Central Asia, who have been, some of them are women entrepreneurs, some of them come from the corporate life, some of them come from academia, and we were all together for 5 weeks. There is a part about sharing our experiences together. So I was astonished also, all the experience I thought I would have is from going to Silicon Valley and understanding how technology is being built there and how big companies have evolved from small startups like Salesforce or Google into the companies that are actually affecting our daily life today and we cannot get actually without their products. And this is all that I expected. I got this. I had very interesting meetings with CEOs from Google, CEOs from Autodesk, CEOs from Microsoft, and they were speaking about how to expand your business, the opportunities they are giving for startups, the special opportunities they were given for women. But more importantly, I understand that an exchange program is more about building the network. So one of the most interesting experiences I got to know is about women and entrepreneurship and women in Rwanda, the women representation. So we thought that Silicon Valley would be the ideal place for women breaking all barriers, but as statistics and numbers that Salma was just sharing for Egypt, there is the second country that in terms of women representation in the parliament, in terms of women representation in technology in the governmental sector and in private sector, the second country worldwide is Rwanda. So I was actually taking experience from my Rwandese friends about how they are breaking the glass ceiling and how they are having different opportunities in Rwanda, not from Silicon Valley. So I got from this actually program, the sisterhood that they were speaking about, where they were actually providing me with opportunities that I wouldn't have if I hadn't been to this exchange program. So I was interested in providing technology for underprivileged children. And I was just speaking or chatting about it with a group of friends at the exchange program. And then the second day I was meeting Sal Khan, the founder of Khan Academy, to talk to him about how can I start something related to the underprivileged children in Egypt.
Great.
So yeah. I think what we got is the sisterhood, the network, the opportunities. And today when I was speaking about this panel, what I got actually of what to share with you is they told me I need to share with you exchange programs, which are just 5 exchange programs to mention their names so that you have something to look it up and to start applying to these exchange programs, which are Tech Women, the Eisenhower Fellowship for Women who are middle sector, and there is the Swedish Institution for She Entrepreneurs for Entrepreneurs, and there is also the program that is related to IBLP, also under the Institute of International.
Thank you so much. That's a very actionable item we're taking out of the panel today. So I think you've all mentioned that there are opportunities, that one of the important things is for women to take charge, whether through taking steps like education and exchange programs early in their careers. And then they have the challenge of how to get ahead in the corporate. And a lot of times there is this discussion about how women need to leave some of their traits back outside the corporate so that they can really get ahead. And I know, Amira, that you've mentioned that you have a different view of this. On this, can you share it with us?
I have a completely different view, actually. So it was mentioned earlier that the ecosystem that we're operating within right now was predominantly established by men, and definitely there's a majority of men today. That in turn has shaped the form of success and the type of relationships and how people actually see success in the workplace. I personally believe and have seen firsthand at Facebook the fact that women bring a lot of traits into management that are very, very valuable. Case in point, the ability to mediate. The fact that you can walk into a room with folks who are not exactly seeing eye to eye and not feel like you need to, you know, put a stake in the ground and bring people to your side of the table, but in fact sit and listen and try and see where they could potentially meet. Now, I know that's not exclusive to women, but it's definitely something as women we kind of do a lot of, or have been, you know, we've learned how to do. It's something we can bring to the table. And that should be seen as a strength. It should not be seen as a fallback option because I can't shout loud enough in the room. So there are a lot of feminine traits that are extremely important to management and to your success, both both within corporations and with customers and suppliers and other entities that you would have to work with either as an entrepreneur or within a company. Another example would be your ability to mentor and nurture. So being able to sit, identify people who need development in one area or the other, and have the patience and dedicate the time to make sure that they get over whatever gaps they have and can get to the next level. Now, we all know women do that quite a bit. So the point is, do not take those things off of your resume. In fact, put them in there, and when you're sitting trying to get funding or trying to get a job or trying to get the next job, you should actually be proud. You should put this up front and center and say, hey, I've done this, and here is how it has moved the needle on your business, my business, somebody's business, because the landscape needs to change. This isn't a situation where we're saying women are behind. They need to learn the ropes that are existing today, and that's how they become successful. No, we need to change the landscape. It needs to be an even playing field, and not just for the sake of being an even playing field, but because we bring a lot to the table that everybody can benefit from. Now, just one other note other than the traits. I actually think this is not a conversation just for women, and I have to tell you, I'm a little disappointed that there are more women than men in this room. And the reason why there is, I am disappointed is because it really is everybody's issue. So, for example, at Facebook, we started by giving paternity leaves, which actually Mark is on one today. Mark Zuckerberg is on his paternity leave today, because when he is on his paternity leave, his wife can actually have a more sane transition back into whatever she wants to do, and it becomes more leveled out. Now, everybody needs to take that responsibility, and that's why I mentioned earlier a very big aspect of your success in your professional life will fall on your decision as to who you choose to be with for the rest of your life. And I keep kind of underscoring this because it is extremely important.
Amen, sister.
Yeah,
I hear you.
Yeah. So I think this is really interesting because also it's one of the topics that that was in Cheryl's book, in the Lean In book. So there has been this kind of discussion happening all over the world over the past years about how women need to self-advocate more and to choose the right partners and then to push on them more to do more and be more involved. Basically, the concept of leaning in. And maybe in the Middle East, sometimes some women are afraid that when they do that, they will be seen as too aggressive or too pushy. What do you guys think of that?
Oh, everybody, I'm a Turkish American, and so I definitely grapple with this because I think a lot of people see me as being very pushy. I mean, first of all, thank you so much for everything that you said. I think, number one, men need to be involved in the conversation, and I think that men do want to be involved in the conversation. At least in my experience, when I've talked to men about the challenges that women face, they have always been really wanting to actually help. You know, if you ask them about being a mentor or trying to create opportunities or bring them, you know, ask them to bring yourself into their networks, I think that they're very open to that. I think in terms of a culture where there are certain patterns and how do you self-advocate for yourself, I don't think we need to change any of our behaviors. I don't think we need to be rude. I don't think any of that needs to change, but what does need to change is the perceptions of a woman who does speak out, and that person is not being pushy, she's not being uppity, and I think that goes to women not mimicking men. And so what's been interesting in running Foreign Policy Interrupted is we provide media training for women. And the one thing that when the women come and we're working with them, they always say, well, I don't know, like, how do I hold my hands because, you know, I talk with my hands, or, you know, how should I dress? And they wanna, I mean, and if you think about it, when women started first going into the corporate world in the 1980s, they used to dress like men. They used to wear these horrible suits with these shoulder pads. I mean, like, oh my God, so horrible. And now women are starting to look like women. And my attitude is own it. You know, put on your red lipstick, use your hands, because your style is your style. Own who you are. And what you need to bring to the table is your substance. And so long as you can actually show people that you know what you're talking about, talk with your hands, talk with your red lipstick, you know, And always be yourself. So I think that we need to change the paradigm of what the behavior is. You know, just because men sit there, I mean, like, frankly, like, when you're watching television and you're listening to those men are boring. Like, seriously? Really? I mean, like, I would much rather listen to women because I think the women are much more animated and I think women tell stories. And I think women know how to connect more. So we need to definitely change the concept of not only what success is, but what behavior is as well.
Yeah. Great.
I can add that I personally believe from all the activities we've done in leadership and in diversity networks and exposure is that there are four C's: confidence, connection, charm, and competency.
Great. So I think we've been talking about the concept of advocacy, and one of the ways in which advocacy can be done is through other support organizations that try to do that. Can we just have an idea about how your diversity group, for example, is helping women self-advocate?
So we have lots of mentorship programs, as you said, and we encourage women to be coached. So be coached in anything you need. Build your support network. And network is not like people who will support you to get promoted. It is people who will teach you how to find your way. It is people who will give you the experience, the relative knowledge that you need so that you can build on it and pave the way through. It is very important that we, as you said, help women overcome their own internal barriers. That is what it is for. We have mentoring programs. We have Breakfast with the Leader initiatives that we said, we've mentioned earlier. We have a job shadowing initiative. And the job shadowing is one of those really different ones that we do from all other companies. We're probably the only one who does this in Egypt. We bring in school students, women school students, so we bring in girls, and we show them how it is to be an engineer. It's okay to become an engineer. And there's nothing wrong with it. You can, you know, you can work a night shift, and there's nothing wrong with that. You could be only the only woman on the table, and it's fine. And that is what you need to do to get here. And you know what? These are your challenges, and that is what you need to learn. These are the coaches you need to have. These are the competencies and knowledge you need to have. These are the personal skills you need to develop. We make them meet HR, and we even tell them how we select candidates, being women in a tech field. I remember one of the notes of the girls, this is my favorite topic, the job shadowing day, and one of the girls said, "It is really interesting how you support sometimes teleworking or working from home for women." And it's always interesting how people try, you could perceive that as that she's already seeing the obstacle or she's already trying to find a solution for the obstacle, but it's still fine. That is what it is for. So not only we encourage women in the workplace, we raise awareness for men. We have a program for men called Happy Men that supports diversity as well. We support students, not only in schools, in universities, to come and see the workplace. And it's okay to, as you said, become a woman engineer. It is always about what you want to achieve. It doesn't matter who thinks what or who does what. You have to put your priorities, your way, your support network to go through and achieve it.
Thank you so much. So I think we should be opening up the floor for questions from the audience. But before I do that, just for whoever wants to jump in, what would be your last words of advice for women to succeed in the workplace and also achieve that magical work-life balance?
I want to add that we're no way over romanticizing the scene and saying there's a lot of opportunities and that the world is bubbly and nice. We're not saying it's easy. It's a hard path, but you really have to build your skills and competencies and also the support network. I have to say I was lucky to have a family that was supportive of me really leaning in. And I have my mom in the room today, but if you don't have a support network, build yourself a support network. Step up for yourself, because it's really about you at the end of the day and about finding your passion, finding what really makes you tick, because that's what will actually help you stay in the workforce the longest. If you're working in a boring job and you're not really achieving much and you're really doing those nitty-gritty details that you really hate, it will affect you and you will probably actually leave the workforce as early as possible and will not really achieve those great things. So really find it put it as a responsibility for yourself. Hold yourself accountable. Say, I want to be the best version of myself, and I want to actually give back. And for the women leaders in the room, because I'm pretty sure it's not only us, there's a lot of great women in the audience, make it a point to not be threatened by whoever really left the workforce early and feel like because they have this stable life or they have this family and they're not really working in the workforce, that they're not really seeing how great you are. Make it a point to actually mentor someone who's like that. Help them find what really makes them tick. Help them find the passion and let them actually lead the way you did before. That's my last thought.
I can add, if you don't mind. Thanks to my husband who sits in the room as well, yeah. And to my man coach who sent me an SMS at 7 o'clock in the morning to encourage me. That is what you need.
Can I just also, one thing that I've learned how to do, I know the time's up, but this is, I actually find this to be useful. You might think I'm crazy. So I think we all have inner voices. And I think for women, I know that I have a negative voice that always says, no, you can't do that. Like, why would you think that you could achieve that? I call that voice Medusa. What I've actually learned how to practice is I learned how to louden the voice of Athena. And Athena is the goddess of wisdom. And so when Medusa talks and I have an idea and I say, you know, I want to go and achieve it. I want to write a book. You know, Medusa says, oh, come on, like, you can't write a book. Like, who do you think you are? I turn to Athena and I say, okay, Athena, what do you think? And Athena says, you go, girl. And the voices are there for a reason. But I think that if you actually exercise, like, listening to that positive voice that believes that you can, I think you're going to get to where you are, like, believing in yourself. So that's just a little tool that I use. You might think it's hokey, but there you go.
So listen to Athena. I think that's a great closing remark. Now we can start having questions from the audience.
My name is Aziza Helmi. I'm senior advisor, former senior advisor to the Minister of Family and Population. I enjoyed very much this panel discussion, which is very informative and very interesting. I just want to mention or to comment that the level of discussion focused mainly on the higher brackets of entrepreneurial women. And I would like to mention that during my days with USAID, with whom I worked for 15 years, I worked with the small and micro enterprise credit and businesses where women were involved. And a lot of them were, you know, excellent entrepreneurs, but they needed self-confidence. They needed, it was mentioned here in the panel. So I remember that one time, you know, I was there in Suhaq, one of the Upper Egyptian governors, and I was asking this micro enterprise entrepreneur a question. She was startled, you know, and she said, no, I don't know anything. There's nothing I know. And then I told her, then who knows? She pointed at some man. When I started asking him the questions, she began correcting his answers. And he admitted that she's right, you know. So she knew, but she did not know that she knew. What I'm saying is that women have a lot of potential. And as Amira said, they can excel and they can offer a lot more, starting from the lower brackets. To end this comment, I proudly mention that I am Amira Rashad's mother. And she did not mention that she is a graduate of Harvard Business School, and she has an MBA from Harvard, which is the top university in the whole world. So for that and many other things, I am very proud of her.
I think we have a lot of support networks for our panelists over here, which is really a sign of how much that makes a difference in people's lives. Any other questions from the audience? I think we have a question in the back.
My question is, I have a baby, as you can all see, and it's extremely challenging. Me and my husband were of the same age and he's very supportive. We graduated together from the same university, but he took the corporate ladder and I started my own business. But very shortly after, I found out that I was pregnant. So that just was a huge kick to my career. But after that, and now maybe 6 months old, and I'm trying to get back on track, which is extremely challenging. It's a challenge every day to get out of the house. So being here today was my first step towards getting back on the horse and continuing what I was doing. It's challenging, I'm sure, not just for me, I'm sure it's for everyone. So I would like your insights on what could be done. I'm sure this is a worldwide problem for women everywhere.
So first of all, she's an absolute cutie. Second of all, I am so impressed that you actually brought her here today. And the reason why I'm impressed is because we, I think, part of establishing your own sort of landscape or starting to make a dent in the landscape is to get real. So I could tell you that I have brought my kids to the office on various weekends where they sat playing PS4 and I finished some of the things I needed to finish. So we talk about work-life balance. It really needs to be work-life integration. You are a mom and you are an entrepreneur, you own your own business. You're not going to compartmentalize those two things and be one thing in the morning and another thing in the afternoon. You need to be both. I can give you a very small example where you're today in this day and age, thanks to technology, you're able to be both. So I need to travel quite often, and I have a teenage boy and a tween boy. And many a time, we're doing homework over Skype. They need to be home at a certain time. I get emailed their to-do lists, one more than the other. But the fact is, use technology. It's 2015. You can definitely do it. And take her to the office and show people that she's there with you and have someone carry her when you're on your call. Basically, you're the same person and you should not compartmentalize.
I have to say I loved it when you stood up with holding your daughter. This is exactly what we all do. You have to know that we've all been there. We all do that. Don't feel guilty that sometimes she's feverish and you need to do something and you'll just give her the medicine, go do it and come back. It's fine. Hillary Clinton was standing in a summit in Massachusetts in 2014 and still remembers when she had to leave her daughter sick at home because she had a court to attend to. You know, I'm not saying that you should always put one priority against the other. It's not the case. You have to be a leader in switching your priorities, in building your support network at home and at work to keep things going. One of them is technology. And don't feel guilty. It is the case for all of us, for every woman, for every man sometimes. And just be proud of it, and you're already doing it.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for being with us. And we hope that we've been useful for you and you have some steps you can take forward. Thank you all. Thank you to my great panelists.
Thank you.